Well, playing game is nice. Makes people relaxed. Some studies even suggest that it can make develop your brain. But we're not here today for that. What does it take to make a game? How can someone develop one? I'm your host, you may call me Anton, and well, today we'll be doing, today we'll be making a simple 3D video using FreeGLOT and C++. So well, what are we going to need for that? Well, for a start, we're going to need a FreeGLOT. And after that we're going to need a Visual Studio, and we're going to also need Visual Studio. Just a second. Which may be downloaded from here. And also, well, I said already we're going to be needing a FreeGLOT. And after that, we're going to need mostly just a bit of a patience. And, well, a bit of a skill. But don't worry about skill, I'm gonna make that one. So, let's get started. First of all, when you actually install Visual Studio, make sure that you have C++ environments installed and that everything works just as it should work. So, File, New Project. And we want to select Visual C++, and we want to make Windows Console application. So, let's call our project 3D Viewer. Okay. Create directory for solution, yes, and press OK. Now while Visual Studio creates a project, let's actually make for a start. Let's make for a start some 3D model that we're gonna use. For that I'm going to use Autodesk Maya. Now if it will start, that would be wonderful. Well, it's starting, definitely. I mean, I can see it here, you don't see it because I put a background screen here. Oh, here we go, splash screen, finally. Come on now, anytime soon. It takes some time for my upload actually, and well, if I start Maya and some game, you know that's actually not a good idea. Somewhere. Okay, folks. Now as for my autocomplete startup, that takes some time. Ah, fine. Am I collaborating me here for once in your life? So, let's make some basic 3D model. It doesn't really much. It's not important how that model should look or what it should do. Just for fun. And well, let's since we can say that. But well, actually, let's go down a bit like this. Okay, so after I create a 3D model, I want actually to save it first as an OV as a Wavefront object file. That's you know, the extension that had that OBG file. So, I don't know if you can see it right now, no you can't, but that's why I basically hate OBS, because you have to show everything. Now I can see it. I'm gonna save it just do this in this block. So yeah. Export out. We want to export as an as a Wavefront object file. That will be format of our 3D file that we're gonna use, and then let's call it model sample. Now, I'm actually not a great 3D artist out there, so... Okay, let's see, save. Yeah, here it is. Our 3D file is ready. So now, let's try to open it for a bit. Scene, let's see, don't save file, import, and then I'll just find like this, simple, go. So, this is gonna be our sample model for our 3D viewer. I also got some models from GrabCAD, pretty awesome service if you are for testing or maybe for developing, but well, we're not here for that. Okay, let me now close my eyes and let's actually start doing something in Visual Studio. Okay, Visual Studio. We actually see some stuff here. So let me show you some. First of all, plan your code. It's really important to grab your paper and pen and actually sketch how your code should work. I actually did that, but well, how much I did that, I already see it in my head, to be honest with you. I have a paper and pencil and sketches. And after that, well, writing in pseudo code or something. Maybe after that, you can also try rendering your route inside the Visual Studio. So well, let's start it out. Now, as you guessed, I'm actually a pretty big fan of Portal. Now, if you're familiar with Portal, you know that story was happening inside GLaDOS. Why actually there's no one inside of Enrichment Center, Sec4, Shell, and GLaDOS. And well, if you don't know, when GLaDOS was first turned on, it actually started flooding an entire enrichment center with a deadly neurotoxin. And well, why did that happen? Because programmers in Aperture Science didn't plan their code. So, plan it. Okay, so I have my project here ready. And well, let's first examine what we actually have here. First of all, we have, two lines of comments here. We have one pre-processor command. And we have that ENT main and some weird return zero stuff. Now, comments are here so you can comment your code. After you start commenting your code, you can write whatever you actually want to write. It's actually pretty neat feature that every programming language offers. And well, it's here so you can actually comment what does that line of code, particular part of code does. So, for example, and well, this thing, this part of text won't be cached by a compiler. So now, after that we have something called preprocessor command. That preprocessor command, why is it called like that? Because it's not gonna be executed in processing. It's gonna be executed by our linker and our compiler, which basically translates our program code into a machine code. So actually machine can understand it, and so it can execute it. After that we have actually, this is basically our main loop. It's called simple main and actually it returns one integer. And usually if our program ends well, that function will return zero to the operating system. So, and if actually it returns zero to the operating system, that means that program ended as it should end. And well, then operating system does its own stuff, and well, frees RAM memory and all resources. So that can be used by some other program or application. Now, what do we have in preprocessor command? We have inclusion of a header. So, why do we actually include a header? We actually include it to declare other libraries or other source files, like we have, for example, here. Or even better, here to show you. Here we have another inclusions, but anyway, what is it actually a header? Well, header file simply contains another code file that that actually contains definition for importing some other code file, if you can understand that. or maybe even library, which is also basically a code, but it's already been compiled, so it's been translated to a language that our machine will understand, not to a language that we understand necessarily. So, we'll be going to do that a lot here. So, after that, this is actually something called procedure. Procedure is actually a closed part of code that, after it's finished, it returns some value to either operating system or to another procedure or function. So, well. Anyways, how it will, if you want to that in real life, how does it work? Well, for example, when you see a friend and then you start a procedure of greeting, and after that procedure is finished, you're probably gonna return to your friend hello, and means to your mind that you're getting your friend and waiting for your friend to greet you back. Although it's not completely correct how our mind works, but it's an example. And well, as I said, in this case, our procedure will return value to operating system, and zero value means that program is closed and it works correctly. So let's try to run it. Wait. Now I'm gonna show you how it actually looks like. Just a moment. Pause. Yeah. There we go. So for now, this is our application. It opened and it closed. So why did it close? Simply because the only thing that's actually happening here is actually that return of a zero value to the operating system, and that actually means that application is about to exit, and well, then operating system terminates application, and then basically what it does is just free all memory and a lot of resources that our program actually needed, that our program actually took from a computer for itself to run. Now we can see here that's actually a development of something called debug output. We can see here that it exited with code 0, so that means clean exit, no errors or anything. Okay, after that, let's see something called Solution Explorer. It's that part right here. If you can see it. And what does it does? Well, it contains all our source files or maybe external dependencies, and also it can contain something called resource files, if we actually want to use it. We can actually also browse our files in the Explorer. Just let me find it. And well, here it is. That debug actually for now stores only temporary files. And well, if you want to see where is our executable, well, it's right there. And it has pretty much. Okay, so for a start, let's unpack our binaries that we just downloaded, okay? We downloaded Freeglot, and we downloaded, here it is, okay. and then after that let's put them into our solution folder. They're right here, so well. We're gonna put them right here, where actually our project is contained. And we're gonna do it like this. Let's contain from that inside. There we go. So, our project file, and after that our preload file. After that, well, let's first of all configure our project so we can actually call our preload, and so we can actually call preload library, and well, first of all, we want to look at this here. We want actually, well, if you happen to have 64-bit machine, and you probably do, then you actually want 64-bit compilation. Now, let's see what happens if we actually did that. It basically does the same. Okay. Then let's make some configuration that actually runs here. So select our 3D viewer project, right click, properties. Now we have a bunch of other options that actually we're just going to edit here. And be careful about that. You don't want actually to select solution and then to save properties. Because that's completely other type of a properties, as you can see. And it's related to our solution, not to our project that we're working. Solution may contain much more projects than just one. And one project is only one project, and for one project we actually define what are we going to do. So we have here a window, and well, let's actually make changes that we want to need. First of all, let's check out the Freelux here folder. As you can see, it has some include GL, and here we have some other header files that we're gonna actually need. So first of all, we're gonna do that. We want actually compiler to check for the directory where actually our header files are contained. So we see C++ directories, and well, after that we actually want to import our headers directory, which is, well, right this one here. So, include directories, headers. Now let's add a new line. Oops, we don't have macros. But includes GL. We can just say freeglut include, so that's gonna be okay. And this one is just move it. Okay, there we go. After that we also want to get to our our library, isn't it? That actually contains that. Oh God. That contains already compiled code. So leave and then x64 because we actually want to include a 64-bit library, not 32-bit library, because if we import a 32-bit library and we compile it as 64 and we actually compile our project as 64, that we're gonna give an error. Well, I'll be talking about that for a lot, and well. After that, we want to add some custom building step, and that's actually, if you checked FreeGLAD directory, to copy that FreeGLAD.dll right with our executable file that's contained right here. So for that, we actually go into build events. We actually open this up, and we want to make a post building event. And we make this. First of all, let's make a description of it. Now output directory, as I never actually told you, this directory where our executable is contained, it's called output directory. So just so you know. And well, we're gonna put here a command. For copying. And then tragedy. $sign that we actually made a maker command to our compiler that it copies file from this directory and this part to our output directory, and we say actually apply and say okay, and well, let's actually build it just for fun and to check if it copies it. It does. Excellent. And now let's actually include our FreeGLAD for start. And to all newbies out there, always comment your code, trust me, it will save your life when you have to read your code after some time after you wrote it. Here we go, this is actually our program now. It works actually quite good. And well, let's now do something that's called initialization of FreeGLAD. it's actually pretty easy and it's not actually that hard. So, for a start, we want to set up some startup parameters of entry point of our main procedure. And we wanna add two parameters. One is number, and the second one is textual. It's actually pretty similar to those if you ever did something into a command prompt and try to run some program and then you basically add some other lines with the name of your program. And here we go. And after that, we basically just initialize free glass with variables of entry points. That's all we do. And that's basically how you initialize FreeGlot library. But we want it to show us a window where our 3D model will be shown. And for that it actually requires also some other parameters. For example, for start we actually need to define a mode how our model is gonna be displayed in that window. So Latin display mode, and well, what kind of mode do we want to? For this time we're gonna have dev buffer, double buffer, and our mode of showing model we're gonna be RGBA. So red green blue colors with alpha channel. And that's how it's done. And after that, we need to actually choose window position where our window will be shown, and we want to say how big our window will be. So for choosing window position, we use flat int window position, and then we put coordinates x and y where our window will be shown. So flat int window position, x let it be 10 and y let it be 10 and semicolon. And after that, glad finish window size. And let's let's say we wanted 800 pixels by 800 pixels. And after that, we basically can create a window that are gonna be shown that we just initialized, and we do that with command glass create window. Oops. And first of all, we choose how our window is gonna be titled. Like here it is, 3D Viewer, Microsoft Visual Studio, for example, OBS Studio or something like that. Let's put "3D Viewer by Gladys" there, and well, that's all. And after that, after we did that, we actually want to get into a main loop of free glass. So our program won't exit by itself. Okay. Let's see now how it works, shall we? Show anything. You just created the window and closed. Let's try that again. Well, yeah, we did. Well, now why that happened? Why actually just created the window and then closed? Well, simply because we didn't tell anything to FreeGlat actually what to do after we enters into our main loop. And usually after you actually initialize the main loop, you actually want it to render itself. So well. Let's create a rendering procedure, and well, inside it we're gonna programmatically create one finder. So for that, above our main procedure, remember above, I'll tell you why a little bit later, we're gonna create a new procedure that's gonna be called render, okay? And it's gonna return nothing, so it's just gonna be void. Like this. And why actually you want to put a new procedure inside an old procedure? Simply because if you're gonna in your old procedure call that new procedure. If you put that new procedure below, it just compiler won't let you. Let me show you. If it's right here, it says it's fine, of course, but render identifier not fine because it's declared after we call it. And if it's declared before we call that procedure, everything will be just fine. So remember that. Always put a new procedure that's gonna be called somewhere above that call. Because otherwise you'll get an error and well, it's not gonna be good. And first of a render, what are we gonna do? We actually want first of all to clear the screen completely. I mean screen inside of our window, not entire screen. And how do we clear it? Well, we simply just erase all buffers. And let's try now to compile it. Wow, still nothing. Well, let's call actually our main procedure. And then it will be shown. So, we're gonna call a procedure that's called glass display func. And inside of it, we're gonna do this. And inside of that, actually, so what did we do here? There's something called register. There's something called register folder. So we basically call one function or a procedure, and inside of it, we tell that parameters for calling that procedure are in some other procedure. So that's why it's called the register callback. And let's try it now. Maybe I'll do this. Still wanna say nothing. Oh yeah, because I entered main loop before I did the register callback. Now do something. We can see our window now, and well. So what now? First of all, let's tell you what, I never like command prompt, so let's get rid of it, okay? How are we going to do that? Well, we have a few preprocessor commands that are gonna help us. For example, if not defined, that's fine, and now let's also change some of the properties. Because of simple hashtag. But still not. crawl inside of a linker, I did something that I shouldn't do. Windows access. Windows. Yeah, it's cool. I know. Now that's better. we don't see that command prompt window, and it's working like clean. Let's now go back to our render procedure and let's try to make some simple triangle, okay? We're using in 3D space. We actually, most of the time, use mathematical matrices. Not film matrix, but mathematical matrix. That's different. I'm gonna show you. So, first of all, we actually want to tell to Freeglad that we want to define something what's gonna be drawn. So we do that by GL begin procedure. And after that, inside of it, we want to select what kind of thing that we want to render. Since we want to render one triangle. There we go. And actually, how are we close it? We actually close it like GLend. And that's all. Now inside of that, we actually want to put three dots, three vertices that are gonna represent our corners of our triangle. So yeah. And now we want to make our matrix. And this matrix will actually basically be 3 times 1 matrix. So 1 row and 3 columns. So first is the x coordinate. Second is y coordinate on y axis. And third is Z axis. Okay, let's do other two corners of our triangle. I'm just gonna copy the command and well change the values. Third one, let's see how it should be. Let's say 0.0, last is 0.5, and 0.0. Comment your code always. So after we did that, we actually just want to swap buffers. So actually that in our so that in our buffer our trigger will be contained and it will be shown, like, and because of that it will be shown. So let's try it out now. There, we can see a 3D model of a triangle. That's actually just a 2D on one simple on actually one on actually 2D layer. But anyway, that's actually something, and that's your first graphical application. Now, what happens if we resize our window? I forgot to show you that. Well, you can make look your triangle really distorted. And when you're actually dealing in gaming industry, you don't want to do that. You don't want to let that to happen because, well, imagine that window is like that and your model actually starts to look something like this here. You want to avoid that at any cost. But well, FreeGLAD actually offers us some really neat thing called the resize function. Let's make new procedure called resize, and well, inside of it we're gonna declare our parameters that's gonna be for resizing everything. Okay. Now this procedure we're gonna have some input parameters, and that's gonna be weight and height. And let's now make a register callback for our resize function, and that's gonna be right below our display function. And it's called actually, and our main procedure for doing the register callback is called the reshape function. So semicolons and dots. Okay, so good. Let's try now to resize our window. Well, it already looks better, but our triangle likes to escape from a window. So now we want actually to avoid that. So first of all, to avoid that, we need to declare a ratio of our size of our window. So we do that. So we're gonna use float command, which is actually decimal number. And after that, well, it looks good, but something's not right here. Can you tell me, can someone tell me what? It's something with that head. Well, let me tell you, what will happen if our height weights, equals zero? That will cause an error, and our program will not behave normally. And we want actually to avoid that all. We actually want to we want to avoid dividing by zero as much as possible. So and we want to put that just before we actually declare the ratio and where we actually do our division. And now let's actually specify what matrix is our current matrix that we are working with inside of projection. And after that, we actually just want to reset the scene, and that will do it. So, oh, semicolon. And after that, we actually just want to set the entire window as our viewport, so actually our triangle will always be visible. And after that, let's set a new perspective that happens when our window is resized. So this is actually, so let me show you what actually that does. So first number that's 40 is actually our angle from y direction. Then it's then after that is our window size ratio. And after that we have z near. That's actually a distance from viewer to near clip plane where actually our rendering won't happen. And so far is actually far clip break. After that point our render also won't happen. So and after that we actually want to continue with our model view, and we basically just adjust our matrix mode again. And after that, let's just reshape our triangle because it's not gonna work like that because we are into a wrong perspective. third one should be 0. This one should be 2. And last one should be 5. Okay, let's try our model. Oh, hello, John. How are you doing today? So now we see our triangle here. It's a bit of off screen, but never mind for that now. But as you can see, now it's always inside center of our screen, and it doesn't escape anywhere. So it only escapes when actually window is too small to be shown. But whenever actually aspect ratio of our window changes, then it works. Then actually it will again work just fine. Okay, so now we want to. So now after we actually did that, we want to add a camera to our scene. So why do we add cameras to our scene? We add them simply because of that thing that actually declares. Camera declares what's gonna be visible inside of our scene. And why actually we have cameras? Why we actually have cameras inside? Because our viewport can be bigger than a camera. And when you point a camera to our viewport, then graphic card will only compute pixels and image that's gonna be shown from a camera. Outside of camera window, that our graphic card won't do nothing. And we actually use cameras simply to simplify tasks for a graphics card. And trust me, when you have a scene that's big like inside of Doom, for example, new Doom. Then you really need a camera. Then you really want the camera, because otherwise, for rendering one scene, it will take you about 2 seconds, and you have pretty much 0.05 frames per second, or even less. So first of all, we want to declare. So first of all, back to our camera. We want to declare angle at which our camera looks. And we want to do it outside of any function here, so just below our preprocessor commands, and why we do that outside of all procedures, simply because if we declare a variable inside of a procedure or a function, that variable will be only visible inside of that procedure or function. If we declare it outside, like we did here, then that variable is global and it's visible inside all functions. That actually can. So that's why we declare it outside. So first of all, we want to reset our rendering scene inside of a rendering procedure. And we're gonna do that just after we do GeoClear. There we go. And after that, let's try to add some camera. And how do we actually add a camera with free glass? We actually call glue look at. So And after that, we just declare where do we want to look. Let's do some magic here. Okay. And semicolon, always semicolon. Don't forget about semicolons. And where do we want to look at it? Well, we want to look at it directly to the triangle. So. We want actually to be x and y parameters to be equal to zero, so our camera will lie down exactly on the z-axis. And on z-axis we're gonna put, well, 10. Some text formatting here, so we can better see what's going on. And of course, okay, let's try to add some simple animation now, shall we? And that's gonna be just the rotation of our triangle, okay? And we want to rotate by an angle. So. And after that we want to rotate on y-axis. And well, let's try now our program. Well, after that, before we try our program, because with that our program will actually not want to rotate, because it will look at just one direction and we want actually to adjust an angle every time when actually we hit that command. So. We actually want to do that, and actually we want to do that just after we end our list, and should we pick? Okay, good. Let's now start the program. But you see that our rotation is not happening, even though if we want to. Yeah, there are some workers in the outside. well, John. Also, they did that this summer also here. Trust me, I just wanted to go outside and yell at them. I understand your frustration, but well, they'll be done soon probably. Anyway, back to our animation. As you can see, our animation is not happening at the moment. Why not? Because we simply did a register callback for rendering our scene, and when our program actually started. But now we actually have to add rendering register callback for the rendering when actually glut is idle. So how do we do that? We have really simple commands for that, and it's called glut idle pump. And let's try it now. Oops, maybe that's a little bit too fast, but as you can see, our triangle moves. Let's put that there 0.01, not 0.1. And it already looks better. So, what after that? Now we actually want to add some input system. I'm gonna do it just to show you how actually you add input system to a free glut. Not because we're going to need to, but I'll do it. So, let me first of all do some little bit of text formatting. There we go. And with size, we can actually do this. This. We're gonna need main now. So what do we need? We actually need a procedure for processing keys for that, and that function will process all keys that are not function keys, like F1, F2, control key, page down, page up, home keys, end key, and so on. And well, for that we're gonna call it keys, okay? And we need unsigned char that's key. We're going to need x value, and we're going to need y value. And let's open and close it. And always, always comment your code. Now for a start, let's add escape key. So if our key is escape key, then we want actually to make our application to exit. Okay? And let's try it now. Well, I'm pressing escape key, but nothing happens. Why is that? Well, because I still didn't put something that register callback for processing keys. and we're gonna put that just after idle function. Okay. I have to put one characters. And let's try it now. Okay, I'm ready to press escape key. I press escape key and that program closes. Exactly what we wanted to do. Okay, shall we do something a little bit more with keyboard, like for example function keys. For that we're gonna need also a new procedure. And that procedure will be called function keys. Let's open and close it. Okay. Now I'm gonna also teach you how to use a switch statement inside of C++ because your code will look messy if you use switch function when you actually process a lot of information. So actually, when we have that, we're gonna actually declare a switch. But before that, switch statement actually allows you to test a variable equally against a list of values. So each value is called a case, and the variable being switched on is checked for each case. So let's start typing some code inside. Switch key. Open, close. Oops, I forgot to add something here. We actually use a lot of those, and we actually need some input variables for entering into our procedure, so that's why I actually did that. Okay, so switch key, open and close. Okay. Now, let's for example go with key F1, okay? Then okay, if our key was actually F1, then we put some code here, and after that we want to exit from a switch statement, and we do that with the command break, and that's all how it works. After that, let's go with just copy this because I'm gonna need it a lot. And I can and so on and so on. So now what? So now I'm gonna actually put inside all special keys that Freela supports. So it goes for F keys and well. We can also put direction keys. So also we can do F up, right or down. That's actually all as they do. Let me actually do this and well. Down arrow, also some fold and well. We also have a page up, page down, home and insert. I'm also gonna put that so just for you so you can see it. Okay. Also have home and insert. We have also end key. And last but not least, insert key. And well, those are all keys that special function key also supports. Let's make, for example, for F2. We're also just gonna put command just for exit. And then break. And that's cool. Okay, so let's try it out. Remember F2 key. What if I press F1? Nothing. F3, F4, F6. But if I press F2 key, oops, nothing happens. that. Yeah, because of what? Because I forgot to add register fallback for. Because I forgot to add register fallback for special keys. Space carry glass. Special. But it's let me just check it out. I'll show this, yeah, that's good. And then now let me see ahead and far, so it will make life a lot easier. Okay. Special keys, yeah, that's cool. Yeah, nice. Yeah. You just want. Well, I kind of forgot to add into my code plan. I forgot to add actually a function for calling special keys. So nothing too special, but you know, sometimes you forgot the API or something like that, and then this can happen. Special funk. Okay. And then how do we call it? We call it function keys. You want to make it right, and then out of the sudden, actually, what happens? You don't mess up, but you forget something, and then out of the sudden, you start to make a lot of typos. So, anyways, if you press F1, nothing happens. If you press F3, F4, or any other key here, but if you press F2, our program exits. So, that's good. But, what about keystrokes? Wait, before that I wanna show you modify keys like this is Shift, Control, Alt and such. So how do we do that? Well, first let's make a function called modify keys. Let's call it modifier keys, Jamie. And after that, we need to declare modifier. We need to declare one variable that's gonna be local and. So inside of procedure, and I'm gonna call it modifier, and it's gonna be numerical type of integer. Like this. And I also wanted to, before I put semicolon, let's declare its value declaring it. So I want to actually make sure that we get modified keys from the people. So we actually have a really nice function for that in FreeGlad, and it's called glad get modifiers. Okay. And we can use now we can again use a switch statement. So we actually have just three modifier keys, so that's Alt, that's Control, and that's Shift key. So and we always check what key is pressed, not what key is not pressed. After that is Control. We have Shift key. And of course, and that's all of our modifier keys. So we actually don't need that part of the code. So I'm just gonna comment it, and I'm gonna use multi-line. find this like that. And also about function keys, I'm also gonna comment them all, because we pretty much are not gonna need it. There you go. If we're gonna need it, then we easily can uncomment that part that we are gonna need, and then well. So why did I comment it all? Well, simply because if I don't need it, but I want it to be inside of my code, then I don't want to compiler to catch on it. Why? Simply because if compiler catches on it, that means that it will put it inside of a program. And if it puts inside of the program, that means that the program will run more slow. It's something called optimization. We're also gonna talk a lot about that here. So after that, let me actually show you also something. There is my ID, yeah. Do we actually need to process everything? Do we actually need to know all ASCII keys? What do you think? Do we need to know all ASCII codes of all characters inside of our using FreeLab? Well, let me tell you, we actually don't. I'm also gonna use a switch statement here. Why? Because it's faster, and because it makes code look much better. So let's first put back our escape key. So now, do we actually need to know all ASCII codes or four characters? No, we don't. Then what do we use? Well, watch this. For example, let's put angle plus one. Like this, for example. Okay, let me just check if I did everything correctly. I probably did, but it's always good to check. Okay. Now, escape key. And now, R key. mostly because that that it's basically put inside here, but what if we increase by 0.5? Let's make it by 1.5, for example. Yep, it does now. So, pressing R key, it actually makes our angle to, it actually increases our angle by, what did we put, 100.5. And then after that you displace it. Okay. So now we want to load our 3D model, right? Because that's why we are here. So first of all, let me actually, I don't want to comment that. Let it be like this. Precise function and then a function and also one integer. So now we want actually to load our 3D model, right? But first, let's examine actually how our 3D model basically looks like when we open it as a textual file. So now you see some weird numbers and weird lines, but I'm gonna tell you what they are. So you see those V lines. We actually see that we have some patterns here, and you see our V lines. Those V lines represent our geometric verticals. Each 3D model. Every 3D model is made out of triangles. And triangle just like in our example, maybe a little bit different shape, but it's triangle. Now, why is that? Certainly because of physical limitations, you can't make a perfect sphere or something like that. If you would like to, you would need to break one pixel into infinite number of smaller pieces. And since triangle is the most simple geometry character that exists out there and can be represented as a single plane, then we use the triangles for building 3D models. Now, 3D models aren't absolutely precise when it comes to making complex geometrical shapes like sphere, for example. Like I said, you would need to fit infinite number of pixels on screen. But what can we do then? We can approximate it. And that's what we do in all computer graphics. We approximate curves. We use a lot of different colors to make those straight lines look like curves. And we are actually pretty good at this. We have also a number of algorithms for that, and most of them are already embedded into our graphic cards and APIs. For example, let me show you. This looks like a circle, right? But how does it look like a magnifier? Let me actually open it. And let's zoom in for a bit more. As you can see pixels here. It looks more something like this. So how do we actually approximate a circle? First, we check that pixel should get the color of our circle, and we do that by using something called midpoint sinkhole algorithm or Brenshan's algorithm. After that, we just to make it look nicer, we put some light shades on the color of our circle to fully approximate it, and we call that that kind of circle we call this Bezier circle, or whatever curve we want to draw. So Bezier curve, Bezier ellipse, or anything. Mathematical basic for that is actually from Bernstein polynomial called after Sergei Natanovich Bernstein, who was a really awesome Russian mathematician, by the way. And Bezier, I think, is from Boris Bezier. He's most notable for subtle testing technologies. So, like I told you, we're gonna talk a lot about math here too. But well, I'm not gonna do it now. I'm gonna do it on the next stream. For now, I just wanted to show an example of how we can actually make a 3D model. But are you scared because I'm talking about math? Well, don't be that much. I'm gonna try to make it as simple as possible. But if you don't like math and you don't want to learn it, then sorry, game development is important. Okay, let's go back to our 3D model. So we have something called verticals here. So those represent, so verticals, what they are, they are actually corners of our triangles. After we they are declared, then we have also X coordinate, Y coordinate, and Z coordinate. After that, we also have something called VN lines. Maybe even VT lines, but well. Let's go first with VN lines. VN lines are actually vertex normals. So those are VN lines, yeah, vertex normal lines. So we're using normals to make our model smoother, not to look like a bunch of triangles and that are placed in shape of our model. But we're gonna a lot of work with normals, map or UV maps, as they're called. Why do we place them and how do we use them? We have also VT lines. Like here, for example, those are basically texture coordinates that we're gonna put on our 3D model, so it can get color and it can get particular lighting and something like that. We also have somewhere. I actually did a lot of wonderful job of exporting it. I mean, it is a nice job, but well, it actually messed up because software usually puts VN lines and VN lines in order. So first there go V lines, then VN lines, and so on and so on. So for example, we also have something called F lines. F lines are basically just coordinates for shading, mostly. And they are basically polygonal face elements, and we use them for defining the mesh and if elements, especially if elements are different than geometric verticals. So, okay. After we examine that, we also have one here. This one is actually a bit longer, I'm gonna show you that one too, don't worry. So, okay, after we did that, let's look at our code, basically. So basically, what we need is a render function. So now we don't want anymore that I'm actually gonna comment this triangle because I don't we don't want it to be visible when it gets. So I'm gonna comment this. I'm gonna comment it all like this. Okay. Angle, we're gonna leave the angle because it's not gonna do anything. But also I'm also gonna comment it because, well, we don't want any unnecessary lines of our code to be running here. Sure thing, John. See you later. Okay, so after this, we basically removed our triangle and, well, let's make a procedure called load RBR file, okay? And this one will also return nothing, but well, just to make sure, open, close it. And if you would excuse me for just a couple of minutes. Okay, I'm back. So well, we actually started our procedure for loading object file. So it's not gonna return anything, but we're gonna actually also add a little. a little char variable called that name instead of the void. And we're gonna also use a pointer. And we declare pointer by actually pointing an asterisk before we actually declare a name of our variable. So why we use a pointer? Basically I wanna explain what's a pointer first. It's a variable that has a value like every other variable, of course. But the difference between variables and pointers is that pointer's value is actually an address of another variable. Like for example, this time we're gonna use an address of a file on a file system. So why do you use that? We find this actually really handy when you have to pull out debug data specifically, and also when we don't have any other data type that can handle of kind of data that we need actually that we actually need to process. So where you can't use something else, that there is like functionality, like for example in C that can't process objects. Like in C, there is no support for complex data types, and you basically can't pass a variable by a reference to a function. And there we use pointers also. So pointers literally points to a specific memory or location of some variable. There invented us really elegant workarounds for something that doesn't exist, and you have to manage to do it. It is where actually thinking beyond creative begins. So why are we going to use it here? Well, because somehow we want to read an object file line by line and store those values of each line inside of a memory before we give them to pre-glut process and at the end to render. And using string arrays for that, like that, yeah, I wouldn't like to count every line. And this is where our pointers become really handy. So anyway, let's do it. We open the procedure and let's write it. First of all, we need some declaration of a file that we're gonna read. We're also gonna use some pointer of that. So it's easier that way. After that, we actually want to declare a variable for storing character sets, because as you seen earlier, we have four different character sets inside, that are divided into columns. So we have first V, then we have X coordinate, we have Y coordinate, and then we have Z coordinate. So okay, for that, let's declare that value. And after that, of course, we also need to declare. coordinates of our reference. And we're gonna use decimal, because as you've seen, they're also written in decimal places. After that, let's declare one char variable for storing our cherished characters at the beginning of each line. Like, for example, as you see that there's V, then also we have VT, we have, and so on and so on. So we need actually to, so we need to store that, so we can actually make a checkup if what line do we read and what does that line define. Okay. Okay, and after that, we're also gonna want to and we're also gonna declare an angle. I mean, we already have it, and we're gonna use it. But we also need a variable for storing number of display lists, because we need to tell the FreeGLAT how many verticals it will display, and we're gonna index those verticals, and with index we're also gonna put coordinates of that vertical. So and that's why we are actually gonna need that. Okay, we need actually that variable to do that because it's gonna be used inside of load over here and inside of render. That's why it's actually there. Okay, but anyways, let's get back to our procedure. So we want to generate list or inside of a free lab, so we want to read our file. After that, we actually want to check if our file basically exists, because if it doesn't exist, we don't want to pass that to a FreeGLAT. And how do we do that? Simple. So what does that exclamation mark mean? Well, saying C++ exclamation mark in C and C++ exclamation mark means component. Not compliment, compliment. We're not dealing with your precious feelings. Anyway, what is a compliment? It's basically exact opposite of what we make. For instance, complement of legal is illegal. In binary, complement of 1 is 0, and complement of 0 is 1. In this case, we want a variable to store entire file to be full of R file, basically. And complement of full variable is empty variable. So we're basically checking here if our variable is empty or not. So what are we going to do inside here? Well, we're just gonna put comment to exit from program, okay? Now it's not gonna give any error message or something like that. Instead, it's just going to exit from program, and that's all. But with that, we will prevent that we don't have to write, that we need to write else and then put a lot of other things in here. Instead, we just need to write our procedure normally as we do. So, first of all, let's declare GL point size. I'm gonna declare it to be 2.0. So with that we're gonna display our vertical, and it's gonna be visible, okay? And after that, after we actually generated the display list, and we opened our file, and everything's ready, and now we want to actually create our list, our display list, that's gonna store all our verticals that we are reading from a file. So, be careful about capital, small and capital letters, because that will give you an error. And okay, let's open and close that, so we can actually put everything inside. So now, for a start, we're gonna push our projection matrix down by 1, and we're also gonna duplicate it. And inside of that matrix that we pushed down, we're gonna put all verticals inside it. And why do we do it like that? So that basically we don't see that how actually program pops up our verticals before they're ready to display. So, and after that, let's declare that our list is gonna contain points, not random, but points. And okay, now we're gonna read our file. So before that, let me introduce you to something called while statement. What it basically does, it continues to execute all until one uh, all or as long as a condition is met to execute this process. So for example, while if angle equals zero, then this procedure will be executed. And if it's not zero, or maybe if you declare it like that, then it will be executed while it's not equal, while our angle is not equal to zero. But this time we won't be using anything like that. We actually want to make sure. What we actually want to make is actually we want to make sure that we are not at the end of the code, that read will execute as long as we're not at the end of the file. So we want to read one line of our file, and we want to put that line of our file into our variable that we call the chest. So to read a line inside of our file, declare a file, and after that %c, that means we're reading first characters, first column as a char, and after that the rest of columns we want to read as floats. So and we happen to read from a line start. And that's where actually and after that next we store basically store our all of these what are we reading here. We store that into our variables. So line start x, y, z. And that's how we read, and that's basically how we read one part of our file. So after we did that, and comment the code, for God's sake. Because either I will not be able to after that. If you get my meaning. Okay, now we want to make sure one thing. We want to make sure that our chair set equals to 4 and line start starts with V. So close and then if that condition is met, then we want to just want to represent our vertical. And okay. And after that, we basically just want to close our list that we just generated, and later we want to push it the render procedure. So. And this procedure ends here. Now, we are actually missing, before we close our procedure completely, load object out here, we are also missing a few things to do here. We need to pop our metrics back, we need to end list, and we need to close our file so it can be accessible again, and so it doesn't actually read our file into the infinity. So first of all, let's pop our matrix back. After that, let's end our list. And after that, let's close our file. Okay. That's cool, and basically we just made our procedure for reading an object file. So, is it long enough? Well, not quite first. We have to do some. We also gonna do some cleanup and some modifications in order to make it work better. So for a start we won't be needing pretty much anything from this procedure at the moment of all procedure. And okay. First of all, we want to actually clear all colors and all buffers. So and alpha channel as well. That we want to clear most of our buffers. Okay, so that's cool. And after that, we want to replace our current matrix with identity matrix in order to reset, so in order to reset it. Well, if you remember a few minutes ago, we can we actually did that, but non-intentionally. Now we're going to do it intentionally. And that's how we do it. And comment your code. And after that, we want to push our matrix down for a bit again. And after that, we do so we can actually make sure that our 3D model is always actually visible inside of our screen. And for that, we actually need to translate our matrix, actually multiply it. And we're gonna do it right now. Now let's put a color of our system. Now let's put a color of our verticals. So red, let it be 0.9. Green, let it be 0.18, and blue, let it be 0.11. And after that, Just to shape everything inside, let's actually multiply our matrix, our projection matrix, with scale matrix. And okay. And after that, we want to actually rotate, we actually want again to rotate our model. And we want and by x axis 0, by y axis is 1, and by z axis is 0. Now, why did we create the list here? Well, because we're gonna actually just now apply a list that we actually created in our load object procedure, and with that we're gonna call it so we can actually display it. Thank you. let's set an angle. And now let's also make sure that if our angle hits 360 degrees, to make it minus 360 degrees. So it can actually be start from the beginning. So we can actually put it back down. Alright, we need a decimal places in our usual operators. And we also need to put semicolon. So let's call our and with that actually pretty much our render procedure is done, and it basically does now need to call our procedure for loading the object file, and we need to do it before we actually make a register callback for rendering. So now let's also put our object file there with our executable file, because we declared. And now let's run it. Oops. I forgotten that little part. Sorry. I'm gonna fix that. Just a moment. I also forgot to put matrix back. Sorry for that. And at the end, of course, swap buffer so we can scale. Okay, let's run it again. Oops, it exited. It exited because Visual Studio actually, because Visual Studio basically connects its application to your debugging to debug host, and then we would need to put our model to the debug host. But I'm not gonna show you this this now. I'm actually gonna show. I'm just actually gonna run it here. Oops, it's green. Oh yeah, me actually. We actually want to make our perspective. Just a moment here, I'll do my back. Visual Studio basically connects its application to your debugging to debug host, and then we need actually we would need to put our model to the debug host. But I'm not gonna show you this this now. I'm actually gonna show. I'm just actually gonna run it here. Oops, it's green. Oh yeah. Just a moment here, I'll do it. Okay, I'm back. Just a moment, I need to. So okay, now it doesn't show nothing, but well, it's because of perspective in a resize function. I'm gonna change an angle to 60 and I'm gonna put it to 1000, and I think that should be, that should actually do the trick. I'm just gonna run it now and and there we go, here is our model. I mean, it's tiny, little, but, well, it works. Now, let me show you some also different model that I actually tried. For example, these two here. And this one actually is an old one, because I like to test before I stream. I like to test my code, so let's make this one maybe simple one. Let's go and on. See, it's a car, and now let's make some hairy and really complicated example that I have right here. Now don't worry if it hangs now, it will load model eventually. It takes a little bit of time, and here we go. And that's basically how you create a simple 3D model viewer. Now, when I say simple to create, not simple to use. Yes, it may be simple, or simpler to use, and if you make things more simple to use, they are actually more complicated to create. And well, this is pretty much end for today. Not still, because well, even though I actually like coding in OpenGL, I'm actually not a particular fan of Glut. But use it as an example that you can actually make something really fast and to actually display it on the screen, and that's in 3D. So join me next time. Next time I hope it will be on Monday at 19th of November. And then I'm gonna talk mostly about math and how do we multiply matrices, how do we do also different things, and how do we deal with vectors. And well, after that we're gonna try actually to implement that knowledge inside of our code. So thank you for watching, have a nice day, and experiment.